Welcome to the Don Lane Show, seen throughout Australia on the National 9 Network. And now,
okay. Hi. You're ready? Okay. Ready. Hey, let me tell you about some of the things we've got for you tonight. At the moment, the entire cast of Australia's favorite wartime family, there's some of it over there, the Sullivans, are at Hawthorne Town Hall, along with about 500 guests, I suppose. It's really a big to-do out there. They're celebrating the end of World War II. A bit late, but they're celebrating the end of it. Everybody's dressed in 40s gear, and we're going to cross over later to join the party and see what's happening. We've got a few surprises for you as well from over there. Also tonight, one of the world's leading gourmet chefs. His cookbooks have sold in the millions. I'm sure everybody here, or not everybody, a lot of people here would have a copy of one of his books. Robert Carrier will be here, and he's serving what he calls a three-course high Victorian breakfast. Not to be confused with the three-course low Victorian breakfast, which is a cup of Bonox, Vegemite on toast, and a cigarette. Good. All right, now. and our resident zoologist, Dr. David Smith, will be here with an ultrasonic sound machine to show us how blood flows in eels. Well, that doesn't mean much to you, but it's going to be very interesting to any eels watching tonight. It'll be lovely. Anyway, it's going to be a good show. Hang in there, stay with us. Here's a couple of songs for you to start us off. Ross, look out. Here we go now. Yeah.
Love a rainy night. Yeah, I love a rainy night. Oh, I love a rainy night. I love a rainy night, I love a rainy night. I love to hear the thunder, watch the lightning when it lights up the sky. Well, it makes me feel good. Well, I love a rainy night, such a beautiful sight. I love to feel the rain on my face, taste the rain on my lips, in the moonlight shadow. But this song and this heart of mine brings a smile to my face every time. Cause I love a rainy night. Yeah, I love a rainy night. But I love a rainy night.
I can do that too.
But I love a rainy night. Said it made your flowers grow, your roses bloom where others die. They love you, I suppose. And it rained all night the first time you gave your love to me. Now sometimes memory. Well, I can make it through the sunshine pretending you're with me. Oh, but sometimes the rain won't let me
Robert Carrier. After these words, hang in there. Look out.
Okay, thank you. Welcome back.
I think a lot of you would have to be familiar with the name Robert Carrier. His cookbooks outsell any others, and besides being an internationally famous author, and he's a traveler, and a restaurateur, and a gourmet, his knowledge of the culinary arts has made him one of the most famous chefs in the world today. I can't think of anybody more famous. He's recently arrived from London, and he's with us tonight. This is his third appearance with me, and needless to say, I am delighted. Make him feel welcome, will you? Robert Carrier, here. I was just saying to everybody, is there more
snow? I heard what you said.
But there, is there more snow on the roof
oh
now?
Oh, my God, you're lucky I got in it.
Is that right?
I'm so old now.
No, you're not.
How do you do it? It must be a wig.
Yeah, no, it's not. It's all mine. A lot of vitamins and working at things. Well, the third time that I've had you on the show with me, but I've never asked you this. No, it's not. I've never asked you this question. How did you start? What made you become a chef? And
you know, I was greedy. And I still am. I started cooking for my little friends at the age of four. Yeah. And I used to lift up the old pot and cook fried egg sandwiches for my little friends and pour Miracle Whip mayonnaise all over them.
Is that right?
Yeah, and that was my gourmet touch. Hmm. I've come along since.
Some people still do that at parties now. What about you? What do you like to eat?
Oh, God, tell me. Ask me. I like almost anything. We just had a fabulous dinner tonight and lots of wonderful wine. This is really coming along, this wild, strange country you inhabit and live in.
The wine.
It is a very exciting place to be.
You know, you're the second person in less than a week that's talked about the wine. Lauren Tweez from The Girl on the Love Boat series talked about the fact that the last time she was here, she fell in love with Australian wines. And I understand they're selling very well in America as well now.
Oh, they are. They are. We had a 1961 tonight, and you don't ever get those, do you?
No.
I mean, it's only safe for visiting firemen like me.
Is that what they say? Yes. The good ones, huh?
Yeah. Yeah.
What about when you have to put a cookbook together or you put recipes together? I mean, this is one that we were looking at before, Carrier's Kitchen. Mm-hmm. And I was reading through some of the recipes. It was a pork satay thing in here. Satay, you have
it. I'm crazy about in Thai food and Chinese food and all that. It's going to be our new life now.
That's really taken on now. Thai food and Indonesian food and Vietnamese food as well, because they're leaving their
home. The whole East is giving us so much, huh? Yeah. Because we're fat. I mean, some of us are fat. I've heard, you know, that you're all in great trouble here in Australia.
About what?
That you overeat, you eat too much meat, you don't eat enough vegetables, you don't have enough exercise anymore, you're all so rich that you drive around in cars, and that you have high incidence of heart attack. Yeah. I didn't even want to come here. I had to be paid danger money because I thought I might catch it. And that the Japanese who eat cereals and vegetables and very little meat only have 1/7 of the incidence of heart attacks that you have. That the Italians who eat pasta only have half of the incidence of heart attacks.
Well, they always tell you about starch and things. They say you shouldn't have that, but yet that
it's
obviously
doesn't
apply. It's
a whole new game. It seems that the danger is far too much animal fats, and that this is what causes many things, even cancer of the colon. I mean, that's not a very nice thing to talk to about on a family show. We're here to enjoy ourselves. We don't want to talk about that, do we?
Anyway,
if you have a lighter diet and a more varied diet and more vegetables in your diet and a less cooked diet, we'll be healthier.
What are the big mistakes that people make when they're cooking cooking foods?
I think that when you entertain, you mean, or when you cook?
Well, just cooking in general, I think.
I think they overcook. I think we really want to cook only a tiny bit now, that we want to cook for 3 minutes, 4 minutes. And we're busy people, too. We don't want to spend the entire day in the kitchen. Yeah. And that's what Robert Carey's kitchen is all about, that some of our recipes are only cooked for 3 minutes or 5 minutes. We use oil instead of butter in many instances, and we use less meat than we did before.
This breakfast that we're going to go over
this
and
is just
talk
the opposite
to about
of what we're talking about.
Right. This is the total opposite. What does it mean when you say a high Victorian breakfast?
Well, I wondered when you said it.
Well, that's the description they gave me of it. They said this is what royalty is. Is this what Prince Charles eats?
No, this is what they used to eat in Edwardian times. This is kind of a royal breakfast in Edwardian times. Come on over, shall we?
Yeah, sure. Sit down. We'll take a look here.
Wonderful. Are we going to sit?
Yes, sure. You can have the far seat over there, I'll sit in this one, all right.
What do you think of it,
I think it's a sensational spread, but
absolutely.
You pass out eating this much food at breakfast.
Well, they died early, but they died happy.
Now, is this what, for example, Queen Victoria would have
been? Yes, the sort of thing. And through Edwardian times, Edward, everyone ate like that. They always had a cold ham. They always had cold game, usually with a Cumberland sauce. They had oysters. Now, these are marvelous gratin of oysters. They had scrambled eggs and sausages. Where are the sausages hiding?
They must be.
They must be under that. No, that's the kedgeree. They had sausages.
Oh, there we go.
Aren't they fantastic? Great big British bangers. Aren't they wild? And then they had kedgeree, which is one of my favorite things in the entire world.
That looks like rice
and rice
and eggs.
Haddock and eggs and saffron. And ham, and sometimes prawns. And this was, and here's smoked salmon, to go on top, you see. First of all, you have your little scrambled eggs here. I'm going to give you some.
Oh, yeah.
I've been cooking all day here. You know that, don't you?
Have you?
Now, do you know Helpy? Gloria Staley. Gloria Staley from Glogler's helped me cook all this. She said, Robert, anything for Don Lane. Do you know her?
What? No, I don't.
How about a little bit, untouched by human
hands? That doesn't look like any egg I ever tasted.
My friend is going to be pure heaven. You are not seeing this. Don and I are alone in the kitchen.
I'm not really...
We never use our hands. You know that. Do you know in Morocco that you can use your right hand only to eat, and you must never use your left hand? Now, guess what you do with your left hand? I'm not going to let him guess, because I think he's going to guess. Anyway, I took a marvelous friend of mine, a girl, to eat in Marrakesh, where I have a house, and unfortunately, she was left-handed. She had to sit on her hand so that she could eat politely.
Well, would they eat another meal during the rest of the day? I mean,
four
you'd be so...
Four other meals.
Like this one?
Like this one. Because tea was a great institution in those days.
Yeah.
In royal households. They always had a high tea, which was tiny sandwiches, cucumber sandwiches and tomato sandwiches cut very, very thin, scones and buns, and perhaps just a little bit of grilled bacon.
Is that why Henry VIII looked like that size?
That's why I look that size.
Is that...
Where's the camera? I want to talk to the camera and say I'm only 22, but I look older.
What's your favorite thing in the whole world that you like to eat?
Do you know what? If I were really rich, what I'd have every day, caviar. It's the only expensive thing that I love.
Caviar.
Black caviar. Beluga from Russia or Iran.
I went to a restaurant one time and they get those big cans of caviar and
they
pay something
very rich.
$250 or something it was for the thing.
Don't say it.
Anyway, Robert, how long are you visiting us now?
I'm here for the day, but I'm off to Brisbane. I've learned how to say it. I used to say Brisbane.
Brisbane.
I'm off to Brisbane, I'm off to Adelaide, and I'm back to Sydney. And I'm going to come and be on your show every day from now on. So
it's okay
careful.
With me. I'll put on weight. It doesn't matter to me. Robert Carey, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be back with one of the Sullivan's Victory Boys.
Hang in there.
You're all right. I thought I'd show you this. Look at that. That's it. 36 years ago, the world woke up to some very happy news. That sure was happy news. It was victory in the end of World War II. And this is how, this is the Sydney Daily Mirror, and the date is August the 15th, 1945, and that's the way it told the good news, just like that. And Channel 9's The Sullivan Series have also come to the end of the war. They're celebrating in style tonight. In fact, the entire cast has taken over the Hawthorne Town Hall here in Melbourne, along with invited guests for a 1940s-style victory party. At the party, the Sullivan's favorite barman, Reg Gorman. There you go. Say it. Anyway. Hello, Reg.
How do you like that, dog?
Reg?
Yes, sir.
It just looks to me like in 36 years, nothing's changed when it comes to a victory party.
Well, not a thing, but I tell you, it's so exciting. The feeling here is so incredible. I feel as though the war has just finished.
Are you having a good time, Reg?
What do you think, mate?
Yeah. I would think so for sure. Who's there now? Tell me about who's there.
Who's there? Who isn't here? Man, there's everyone. Hello, Andy. How are you, mate?
G'day, folks.
Go away.
Peace.
They're all sort of... Go away.
Oh, look at that, isn't that? We're getting an overall shot, Reg. And,
well, I tell you, it's so incredible. Have you noticed the uniforms here?
Yes, I have.
There's uniforms of every type, and it's just incredible. We've even got a German here somewhere. Mm. He was game enough to come along.
Was he dressed like one?
Well, he's dressed like a Nazi, would you believe?
No chance.
But he hasn't disappeared yet.
How many do you reckon there, Reg?
Well, I'd say 500 easy, mate. And it really is incredible. I'll tell you what. There's crew and wardrobe department. Oh, incidentally, not only the wardrobe department, but all the wardrobes. There's nothing at Crawford's left, I'm sure.
I can
imagine. Really is amazing.
With the invited guest thing, Reg, surely a lot of those people probably had to go out and ferret through closets and attics and everything to find
them. I'm sure they did, mate. I really am.
Yeah.
There's people here from interstate, too. A lot of press. They've made an effort to get here. Even with the strike, they've still came down. It really is marvelous.
And what about special guests, Reg?
Oh, we got a lot of special guests. I'll tell you what, I got a friend of mine here. Damien. Damien, let that boy through, please. Damien, the boy behind you there. I've got a friend of mine here who you know very well. Come here, Damien.
A friend of mine, too. That's Damien Harriman, right?
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
How are you, Damien? Say hello to Damien. That's nice. Good night. Nice young man.
They applauded you. See, he can't hear. Through modern technology, I've got this thing in my ears.
I see, right. Ask him if he's having a nice time. What is he doing there?
Oh, you mean Albert?
What? Yeah.
Well, Albert's always at these turnouts, didn't you know?
He was just here 2 minutes ago. What's he doing over there?
He knew it was a victory celebration. He couldn't miss out, mate. He's had a beer and a grog. He's really doing well.
Wait, that's a blonde, but I can't... Is that...
That's the sort, mate. That's my boss.
Oh, that's your... I know who that is. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Well, as you can see, everybody's having fun.
That's Vicky, right?
That's Vicky, yes.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite ladies in the whole world. That's a beautiful lady, that lady.
She really is marvelous.
Yeah,
listen, mate, there's someone else here who wants to talk to you.
Who's that?
Very important. Jeff Harvey. How about saying hello to Jeff Harvey?
Where's he?
It's so lovely out here. I just wish you were here. You don't know what you've missed. Should have been here at 7:30. We had a quick step, we had a foxtrot, then we had a barn dance. Sensational. We went 1,000 miles down. We split the room up into four. And what we did, we got surprises. And see, you got the big bands here, and we all played. We had your favourite tune, you know, I'm for Everything, that thing.
Yes,
oh,
right, yes.
Sensational, mate. Ah, there you are. Much better. Mate, I tell you what, it's been the greatest night ever. The very greatest night. And I'm glad you're here. Seriously, mate, because you can share.
Have you been drinking?
No, mate. At the end of the night, I will. I'll have a victory port. But let me just tell you what we're going to
do. Yes, sure.
Yeah. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. Hold on one second.
First, you're going to stand up, right?
I'm going to stand up, mate. Follow me. Thank you. Don the part.
They can't hear me, but I can talk in your ear while you're trying to talk to them, can't I?
That's right, you can. Indeed.
Yes, go ahead. You keep talking.
I will do.
Go ahead.
Mate, listen,
you've got a very big nose.
That's
none of them know what he's laughing at. They can't hear me. He's got
Don,
the earplug.
I'd like you to join with the cast of the Sullivans and everyone that's loved the Sullivans for something that's so nostalgic, and I'm sure you'll love it. It's perhaps the song that was the biggest song in the whole of the century, and we've got someone to come up and sing it for you this evening, and we'd like your audience and all the audience on Channel 9 and everybody that had anything to do with the war and happy or sad memories will know this song. Would you put your hands together, your audience, and the audience here for Megan Williams as she sings We'll Meet Again.
song for the bad guys.
Lovely night here. And for us,
that's
we're going to
the
take a break now and have supper.
Well, it looks like they're having a terrific time, and we were very happy to bring it to you. We'll be back with Judy Stone in just a minute. More of that. The lovely and the very talented Judy Stone is with us tonight. The song is called Dancing on the Moon. Put them together. Here's Judy. Judy Stone, look out there.
Hey, dancing on the moon, why can't we hear the music down here? What's going on? Hey, dancing on the moon. Why can't we hear the music down here? Down here we got baseball players, true sayers and soothsayers. Down here we got common sense, a picket fences, a president. People crying how they'd rather die. It's such a good alibi.
Thank you very much. I just thought of something. Is he coming back from that, they're drinking over there, you know. I'm talking about Bert. He is coming back. We got a wheel to do. This could be a lot of fun tonight, you know. If he comes back in the condition he goes home in. No, I don't mean that way. Forget about it. We'll be back with Dr. David Smith in a minute. Hang in there, okay? Don't you go. I forgot the commercial was going to be. One of our regulars and a man that we're always glad to see is Dr. David Smith. He's from Melbourne University in the zoology department. Pretty popular bloke. Say hello, Dr. David Smith. Will you? Come on. I always know when you're going to be here. They bring the pointer out, you see.
That's right, yes. Right. Sort of mini schoolroom.
They place the pointer there. Okay, we're going to talk tonight. They tell me about ultrasound. So yeah, I suppose I have to first ask you what ultrasound is.
What is ultrasound? Well, ultrasound is what its name suggests, I suppose. Ultra-high frequency sound. Normal sound that we can hear operates up to about, I don't know, 10,000 cycles per second. Ultrasound goes to 10 to 100 million cycles per second.
Is this like what they say dogs can hear a high
pitch? It's like a super, super special dog whistle, yeah. It's even higher than that. But we can't hear it, but it's little tiny vibrations.
And what do you do with it?
What you do with it, it's been used a lot in medicine, medical research, because it's one of those devices, a bit like x-rays, but less dangerous, that lets you look inside bodies and do things like look at young children. I've got a picture, actually, just down here, of one of my good friends. In fact, I had dinner at her place tonight. This is Shirley's stomach here. Where do I get my pointer? See, I didn't even use the pointer.
Here, I'll hold it.
This is Shirley lying down, and this is the top of her stomach. And this is her, I think it's about 7-month-old little Nadia sitting in there. And there you can see her skull there and the little teeth developing and the jaw. And down here's her back and there's her arm coming down around here.
So you got how did you get that picture with sound?
That picture's been done by scanning an ultrasonic beam backwards and forwards across her whole body very fast and producing an image just like a TV picture of the intensity of the sound that's reflected back to a receiver. And that's pretty much what we use in the systems I'll talk about tonight. This is a demonstration again of the system that we're using in the eels. What we have here is a blood vessel, and here's some little red blood cells chugging along, and we have a little chugging along here. Well, that's a good point, because I was going to say that this system works on what's called the Doppler principle. And if I said it works on the Doppler principle, no one would know what I was talking about.
Right.
But chugging along reminds me of trains. And if you're ever travelling in a train, zipping along at, say, 60 miles an hour, and you go past a level crossing, you hear the bell go, clang, 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 disappears. The faster you go, the bigger the difference in that sound. So if you're going very fast, it'll go clang, 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 clang. Okay, that difference in sound. Now, picture the red blood cells as
I don't, David, I got to tell you, I don't understand any of that.
Okay.
Well, you mean when you're going past the bell?
Yeah, you've been past a bell.
You mean it goes like ding, 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 ding,
and it changes, it drops down a tone as it goes past.
Well, as you go past it.
That change in tone is directly proportional to the speed of the train, it turns out. And we can use the same principle to get a shift in ultrasound frequency to tell us how fast the blood cells are moving inside this vessel.
So the sound bounces off the red blood cells.
The sound bounces off from one
of these. It tells you how fast they're moving through the bloodstream.
Through the bloodstream.
Now I have a better idea.
So we get inside the animal and we look, without actually invading the blood vessels, we can get inside and have a look at how fast the blood's going in different parts of the body.
Now, can I ask you another question?
Sure.
Why do we want to know this?
Shoot. Why do we want to know this? That's a pretty good question.
I thought so.
Yeah. Well, as I... It's a really a very good question. The answer, and I could sort of fob you off with a whole bunch of highfalutin
technical
answers.
Things. Well,
technical
that's what
things,
I mean. I don't want you to
which
do.
I'm not going to do. The answer is that we're really in the business of writing up-to-date biology books. We're trying to understand how we fit into the biological scheme of things. You know.
Right. So it's to find out how they work.
It's to find out how these animals work. I gave a seminar last year down at one of our medical research institutes. I won't name it. But these people who are top-notch cardiovascular physiologists were very surprised when I told them that toads and eels have blood pressure. Now, that didn't surprise me at all, because I've been measuring it for the last 10 years.
Well, they always use terms like cold-blooded animals with
that's
those.
That's right. And people generally, even these experts, don't necessarily think of these eels and toads as having sort of highly developed systems such as we have.
Yeah.
Now, I think we're putting ourselves into a broader perspective. These animals have got very... well-controlled blood pressure.
Okay, well, we've brought your whole laboratory in here, I think.
I thought I'd bring the whole show in.
At least it looks like it. Anyhow,
come
on, we'll take a look here.
I spend a lot of my time behind this machine, or at least one of my students does.
You stay over here. I'll get around the back so I can talk to you.
Sure. Look, let's start over here with...
Now, first of all, I think people should understand that, David, the first time you came to our attention was because you worked with eels and toads.
That's right, yes.
And you brought those in, cane, toads, and eels, and those kind of things.
I've done, 10 years research on various aspects of breathing and blood pressure control in these animals.
Are these the same eels that go across the land up in Queensland?
Yeah, the same short-finned eels, yeah.
Right. Okay, now what do you do with this? It's got wires in it.
What I did yesterday was do about a 2-hour operation in which I implanted a tiny device just like this one, a little tiny ultrasonic cuff like the one in the diagram. So I put this little cuff inside the animal around a blood vessel and then stitch the animal up and let him recover from the anaesthetic. Of course, he wouldn't want to be anaesthetised.
Right.
And he's recovered. He's obviously quite happy. If I touch
him, awake?
He's well and truly awake. Okay. And this cuff is now producing a signal over here on the machine, which, if I turn it on, should produce a sound which is, in fact, his heart beating, the blood flow rushing out of his heart.
Is that the sort of wow?
That swishing sound, yeah. I might blow the audio guy's brains. I'll turn it up a little bit. There we go.
Some feedback.
There's a bit of noise in here from somewhere. It might be the lights are giving us some hum. If I touch the eel, you'll find he stops his heartbeat completely, and his heart will stop for maybe 10 seconds.
Well, we can't hear that very well because of all that interference. What is that from?
We've got a lot of interference here from somewhere. There's so many wires at the back there, they're probably pulling little loops.
Is this supposed to be unplugged?
Never mind. No, yeah, that's supposed to be unplugged. Yeah, oh, that's sorry, fine. Let's give that one a miss, and I'll show you an experiment that I did, maybe...
Is it less noisy than this one?
It's totally silent, in fact.
Okay.
Look, I recorded this experiment about 3 weeks ago on tape. All of the experiments come up through the wires in the back of the machine. And if I hit that button, and this one, we'll in fact see an experiment coming out. This is 3 weeks ago, now coming back onto the chart.
So the sound is on that tape, we don't hear it.
That's right. Yeah, we can't hear it.
But it's coming out,
it's
translating
coming out
here.
Into little movements of these pins. Let's just go through them in order. We've got pressure in his mouth here. But we had a tube in his mouth to record pressure there, which tells us when he breathes. And at the moment, he's not breathing. We'll see him start to breathe soon.
I certainly hope so.
Yeah. They hold their breath. These eels hold their breath for 20 minutes at a time.
Oh, wow.
This is the blood pressure coming out of the heart, and this is blood pressure downstream from the gills up in his main artery to the body.
Right.
And this is the flow in that vessel, which I've got the cuff around in the other experiment there. He's supposed to start breathing. I'll just speed this up a little bit, and we'll see him start to breathe. Oh, there we go. He's starting to breathe now.
Oh, I see.
No, not
yet. He only took one breath.
No, there'll be more in a second. Here we go.
I see. He's starting
now
to breathe.
Now he's taking some breaths up here.
These are the breaths here, yeah.
That's right.
Uh-huh.
And you see that as his breathing starts, his blood pressure rises and the flow of blood out of his heart increases a great deal.
So what you're saying is that this ultrasound equipment actually takes you inside anything.
Right inside the animal.
Right inside.
That's right.
Would that work on me, for example?
Sure.
Yes?
Do you want to go?
Am I going to make noise like that other thing?
I don't know. You might.
Yeah?
I hope you don't, actually, because it's supposedly nice and silent.
What do I do?
I'd like to take your shirt off. Take your jacket off. And I have some acoustic jelly here.
I hope so. That receptacle there frightened me for a minute.
Just a little dabble, do you?
Okay. I was just mainly wondering where you were going to put it. Yeah, go ahead. It's fine.
Now, hopefully there's something going on in here. Give you a little squirt.
Don't tell me we're out of jelly.
No, we've got plenty of jelly. That's
okay.
Not a problem.
Now, what is this going to do?
Exactly the same as what happened in the eel. I'm going to put this pencil probe, which is the sort of one that the doctor would use at the clinic, onto your arm, and I'm going to try and record the noise coming through the artery in your arm there, if I can find it.
This noise will come through the artery in my arm?
This will prove, once and for all, that you're in fact alive. Got it.
Is that me?
That's you.
That's me.
I've lost it. Wait a minute. You're doing an entry.
Keep going, you big thing. You keep going.
Isn't that great?
I could listen to that all night. Could you?
Yeah.
Well, we can. Unfortunately, we can't stay here all night. Thank Dr. David Smith. We'll be back. Leon Burge has got a song for you in a little. We can do that again. Thank you. I suppose if you had to talk about singer-songwriters and really talented individuals in this country, you can't go past this fella. I think if one of the first times he's ever on television was with us. We're just delighted every time we can get him back. The song is called Reasons. Here's Leon Berger. Say hello.
Except for loving you, baby. why I don't need reasons. Reasons, they make us feel so safe and cold. They guide a cautious mind, so numb the soul.
Don's Wheel tonight, you could win this exciting new Toyota Corona CS manual sedan valued at around $7,680 on the road. Your new Toyota comes to you with the compliments of Pit Stop Motors of South Yarra, St Kilda and Elsternwick, one of Australia's leading Toyota dealers. And don't forget, Pit Stop Motors want your business. And the South Pacific Cruise with Sitmar. You'll enjoy the theatre, swimming pool, deck games and first-class entertainment and bars on Sitmar's Fairstar, the resort between ports. And the best in home entertainment equipment with the Radio Rentals remote control video cassette recorder, which has all the latest features. Rent from Radio Rentals colour TV video. And a $1,200 wardrobe from Anthony Squires. To the discriminating man, Anthony Squires clothes are a way of life, with style inherited after years of West End tailoring tradition. And a diamond pendant to the value of $1,200 from the superb diamond collection of Theodore Fine Jewelry, renowned for the most beautiful jewelry in Melbourne, maybe the world. And this package, including the Electrolux 720 vacuum cleaner, the mobile Electrolux refrigerator, and the Flymo electric lawnmower, which mows quietly and safely.
I brought an old mate of mine. I haven't seen this bloke. Haven't seen him in 30 years.
Aren't you lucky?
This is me. This is my old mate, Chocker.
Is that him, yeah?
Chocker. This is Don. He's an American, but he's not a bad bloke when you get to know him. You know what I mean? Chocker?
Nice to talk
to you. We call him Chocker because whenever the enemy arrived, he's always chock-a-block up a tree.
Is that right?
He's a real carry. Funny.
Yeah.
A funny man.
Is he, yeah?
Look. Tell him. Go on, Chucky. Hey, listen.
What is he doing?
It's amazing, the old friends that I haven't seen them since the war finished. Marvelous, wonderful people.
Yeah.
I saw Snowy. Snowy was my best mate in the Second World War. He was a wonderful, wonderful man.
Where'd you meet him? In Ceylon?
No. We went in Greece and Crete, and we went over the Owen Stanley. Stanley wasn't too wrapped up.
I wouldn't be surprised, yes.
Was he a womanizer? Could he get himself a boozer?
Yeah.
And smoked like a chimney. But I tell you what, a fine chaplain. Would you like one? Would you like one, eh?
Yes, what do you got?
Beer, but this is...
I don't drink, you know that.
You can have a beer, can't you? How are you, Jock? You okay there, Chocker? A bit nervous, I suppose, this week, are you? Hey?
No, he's okay.
He's a
I was wondering if Dawn Lake will sue.
He's a good-looking fellow.
Oh, he's quite a good-looking bloke, yeah. For a man.
Yeah.
He's married, you know.
Is he?
Yeah, we're not saying hello to your wife, Harry. We got no.
You want to take Chaka back somewhere so we can go have a rest, will you? And get about
go and put him in his kennel for a couple of minutes.
Nice talking to you, Chaka. It's a wonderful experience. No, I'm not. I don't drink.
Look at the amazing... Look, that is an original label from 1945. Isn't that amazing?
Let me see.
Yeah, Melbourne bitter.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
What about the glass?
The original glasses, too. We got these in your dressing room.
Yeah, but wait a minute. I use these for something else.
You really?
Yes.
You're kidding.
Well, you have to take one in every Thursday morning.
You're still doing that, eh? Okay, yeah. Right. Let's have one just for the hell of it, eh?
I don't want... I can't...
Oh, come on. One little beer is not going to hurt you. Good, straight. You've got every other failing in life. Won't have a beer, too. There we go.
But I don't want to... You know, like, I don't
it
drink...
It won't hurt you, Don. You'll see a brand new slant on life. There you go.
What do I do? Drink it or shave with it?
That's what I call a head. Let's try that. That won't hurt you. It's ice cold.
That's not what we call a head.
What do you mean by that?
Nothing.
Was that around in 1945?
Yeah, right.
Okay. Bottoms up.
Oh, well, there we are. Over the lip and over the... one of those. Give me one of those.
The fleecy cloud may kiss the sky. The rose may kiss the butterfly. The evening mist may kiss the grass. And you, my friend, good health. Hey, listen, I also brought back for you, Don, some original...
Is this what they've been talking about all these years?
It's honestly, you don't know what you're missing out on. You're going to hit 60 years of age, all of a sudden start having a few beers and regret what you haven't done during life.
Is that right?
There is more in life than women.
Yes, you have.
Good health.
Is this stuff take the place of women?
It certainly... Well, it can. You know what I mean?
Is it really?
You drink enough of this, you don't notice they're not around.
Helping in this small...
Lovely drop. Like to meet our first contestant, Don?
Yeah, sure, why not?
There we go. Our first contestant...
Bring her out here!
A two-pot screen.
Get her out here!
Our first contestant, Don, is Mrs. Fiona Thiel of Anderson Road in Faulkner. Hello. Hello, Fiona. Good to see you. Straight to Don, she went.
Aren't you pretty?
She's lovely.
Hello. Before we talk to Fiona... How was it over there? Nice?
Well, at the Hawthorne Tower... Oh, yeah. Look, honestly... I only regret that I didn't get Patty and go there and spend the night after the show, you know, for a couple of hours.
No, it really looked like everybody was really having
fun. Let me explain that, Fiona, you don't mind, do you?
No,
aren't you? You're the prettiest contestant we've had in a long, long time.
I would say so.
Why did you go straight to Don when you came on? Why did you bypass me? He's more your type, eh? Anyway, over there at the Hawthorne Town Hall, the beaut thing is that there are so many young people who wouldn't remember the Second World War, but they are really in the atmosphere, and no one is sending it up, except Wally Ritter, who's in charge of... What's Wally in charge of here? In charge of facilities, cameras and things like that. Wally is he's a German. You know, he's a German-Australian. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And he has ways and means of making people quick. Pardon? He's a Swiss. No wonder he yodels in the passage.
He's not German.
Well, I don't know. I reckon he might have changed his passport. Anyway, he's over there and he's dressed as a German. So you can imagine everyone standing around in army and navy. All of a sudden, this German walks in, and the whole thing parted. Beautiful. But they're having a ball,
Don. But he's not German, he's Swiss, you said.
He's Swiss.
Yes.
Yeah. I think
he's
neutral.
I saw him out with the two women, and I said, you go with that girl. He said, and the old lady, too.
That's right. Yeah. Yes, yeah. That's right. That's 1945.
Yes, that would be about the right minute. Yes.
Fiona, what number would you like, my love?
17, thanks.
17. Are you about 17 years of age?
No.
Well, Fiona's married. She's got a very, very large husband sitting over there.
Really?
I checked this all out earlier.
Let's have a look. Which is her husband?
He's the one with the mo.
Oh, the good-looking one.
The one with the mustache. She looks like he's swallowed
Fiona.
A dog.
Fiona.
That one there, yeah.
Fiona, you could have done better than that, Fiona. I'm only joking.
Tony, what does he do for a living?
He's just graduated in economics.
Graduated in economics.
Oh,
wonderful.
Well, that's clever blokes, eh?
How much things should cost.
Okay. And good luck to you, Fiona.
Here we go.
Also on the wheel tonight, you could win a TAA Duck Island holiday for two for 1 week and you'll fly there and back with TAA the friendly way. And a superb collection of citizen watches and clocks to the value of $1,200 from the Ranger Prouds, Australia's national jeweller. And the Kelso Cash Barrow, your choice of the Kelso Slogger or the Kelso Ladylike Barrow, filled with $1,200 cash. And a choice of ladies or gents emerald rings to the value of $2,000 from the Aga Khan Emerald Mine for the compliments of Great Eastern Mines and Lightning Ridge Mining.
This is a car. No, it's too fast. Too fast for a car. No, maybe it's not. It might get the second time around. This is a big possibility here. This could be a car. No, short. One short. Too short.
No,
Number 19. We should have changed the music this evening, Don, for the 40s style, rather than having all that loud, glaring music. Hopefully we'll be gone by Monday.
What would you like him to play?
Oh, what about I'm in the Mood for Love? Would you like me to sing it? I'm in the mood for love, simply because you're near me. Funny, but when you're near me,
what about 1945? Talk about 45.
You stopped me then because I was going well. You didn't want to be ashamed. Okay.
Never mind, I saw you with Vicky Hammond, and then I'm jealous.
I tell you what, she's a nice girl to put your arm around. She is lovely.
She's a beautiful lady, too.
Okay, you've got the chance here, Fiona, of a choice of one of two things. A 63 national, I beg your pardon, a national 63 centimetre slim sonic full colour television. What are you doing there, Don?
No, I was just trying to see which one it was on, 20 or 19, Dan.
Oh, it's okay. I didn't know what you're doing. From National, or from the Australian Bullion Company, gold to the value of $1,200. What do you say? What's your husband's name?
Wait a minute, he's economics.
Yeah, well, he should
know. Economics.
Mark, what do you reckon, Mark? The money or the box?
I'll take the gold.
Take the gold. Yeah, I would think so. It'll probably be worth more tomorrow.
Okay.
Bert will tell you all about gold.
Yes,
he knows all about the market.
Invest in gold. He said to take the gold.
He's done it all.
Would you prefer the television set?
I'd listen.
It's your prize. I mean, bugger Mark. I mean, he's just your husband. It's your prize.
Oh.
Take the gold. Okay, the lady has the gold.
Which historical event took place in 1945? Man made his first moon landing, World War II ended, or the first talking motion picture was made?
World War II ended.
How did you get that?
Isn't that good?
Oh, thank you.
We're back with you soon after this break.
We certainly are.
All right. It's back to the wheel. On the phone from Narracoot. In South Australia, we've got Mona Maher, Don.
Hello, Mona.
Hello, Don. How are you?
I'm very well. How's South Australia?
Oh, very good. Very beautiful weather.
Yes. And are you a married lady?
Yes, I am.
What does your husband do?
He works for telecom.
Hello?
Hello.
Hello?
That's right. He's a hello.
He's a hello. He works for telecom. In the field or in the office?
Out in the field.
Out in the field? Oh, here's the guy's a half a millionaire. Say hello to him.
Hi, how you doing, Mona?
I'm good, Bert. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you.
I was just watching you at the Hawthorne Town Hall.
Look, Mona, what sort of age group are you in?
About yours, a bit older than you.
Well, I'll tell you what, you should be over there. Really
She's
is
over 50. She doesn't sound it.
Oh, it's terrific. It really is great. Can you see my medals?
Yes, I did, yes.
Look at them, eh?
What was this
great,
one here?
Aren't they?
That one there, that was for attending the 1945 Grand Final between South Melbourne and Carlton.
And this one here with all the pearls on it.
That was given to me by a French general. He kissed me on both cheeks.
Is that right?
And then on the face.
That's.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And what's this one here?
That's a special producer's medal, which is awarded to very few people here at Channel 9. But I managed to get one, yes. Yep. And this one here, well, of course...
How long ago were you given that?
This is...
long service,
long
was
service,
it?
Yes.
Was your last 6 months?
3.5 months, yeah. And this one here, of course, is my gold logo. He melted down.
Is that right?
Yeah. Mona, what number do you want, love?
One.
One, okay. Why number one?
Why number one?
Yeah.
Well, I'd only sent an entry in a week, 1 week before it came out in the...
Yes, hang on a sec.
Yes.
Yeah.
Put out.
So that's 1 week ago.
Yes.
That's why you're going. Just hang on a sec.
Yes.
If I move away from here,
come on.
And there's a close-up of Don, that means there's one person on camera. One and one makes two.
Wait a minute. It's two of us is four.
Yeah, four.
Four. And you take away the three kids on the floor.
It comes
one.
To one. My
right.
God,
I
yes,
can't
it could
believe
be
it.
Out.
It all worked out. Does that mean if she lands on one, does she get the car?
And also on Don's Wheel tonight, you could win this 13-day luxury Brisbane Gold Coast coach holiday from AAT, where Armchair Comfort and Service is part of the package. And keep you cool all year round with a car air conditioner from Motorcool. Custom-built or fully integrated systems fit any car, plus a 12-volt electric car fridge for really cold drinks and snacks. And $1,200 cash from Amcal Chemists. Try Amcal's new double-strength blackcurrant flavour Mega C. From Amcal's extensive range of own brand vitamins and the TAA Great Keppel Island holiday for two, you'll have 1 week to enjoy fishing, swimming, exploring, or just relaxing on this Great Barrier Reef wonderland, and you'll fly there and back with TAA the friendly way.
Not a bad chance here, Don.
It's a good even money chance.
60, 70, 80.
Oh, very
nice. 9K is number one. That was very, very cut. Mona?
One off.
Yes?
You know, you landed, you were one off. You landed on number 20.
True.
But it's okay. You've got a very, very good prize here. You've got a choice of prizes, actually. Here's Bert tell you about it.
Yes.
Do you like painting?
Painting?
Yeah.
Not particularly.
As in Rolf Harris, as against Picasso, you know?
Yes.
Well, you've got some British paints, pine wood furniture to the value of $2,000, plus your choice of timber finishes. $2,000, or from Theodore Fine Jewelry, an exquisite diamond pendant, the value is $1,200. Which one do you want, Mona?
What was the first one again?
It was a pine wood furniture prize.
Furniture?
Yeah, valued at $2,000, plus your choice of timber finishes to paint the thing. Okay?
Yes.
Or you could win from Theodore Fine Jewelry, exquisite diamond pendant, one that you throw around your neck, and the value is $1,200.
No, I'll have the pine wood furniture.
Really? I would have gone the other way, but then again, we're all different, aren't we?
Hello?
Hello?
Mona,
yes.
Which American band leader of the 40s created such evergreens as In the Mood, Chattanooga Choo Choo, and Moonlight Serenade?
Oh, my God.
No. No, he wrote Nearer to Me to Thee.
Yes.
what was it again?
In the Mood. In the Mood, Chattanooga Choo Choo, and Moonlight Serenade. Da, da, da. How does Moonlight Serenade go?
Da, 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 da. Da 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 da, la di, la da da, la da da, la da da, in the moonlight.
Who?
The bloke with glasses.
Give a choice of three.
The bloke with what?
Glenn Miller.
Yes!
Glenn Miller is right! That's it. Sure, you got it. All right.
If you'd like to be on Dance with Punk, 333 Richmond, 3121. Around we go. Don, I think this will
be a
very nice opportunity to welcome back to Channel 9 in Melbourne, and also indeed to the Don Lane Show, the founder of the program, who was with it for the first 4 years, has been away in Sydney for the last 15 years doing... 15
no,
months.
It seems like 15 years.
Doing things like the Royal Charity Concert and 25 years of television, the Hogan Shows. I just thought it might be nice to welcome back Peter Feynman.
Yes, it would be nice to welcome back Peter Feynman. We should all do it, too.
So there you go.
I love people who don't just say, oh, I know the name, I know the name.
It's nice to have him back.
What is that noise? Peter's up there.
What did you take in the sweep? I took 3 months. What did you take?
He's up there in the booth trying to fit his nose back into the...
Oh, come on, now, don't be like that. I'm delving really deep tonight, right down here. There you go. I've got Mrs. Glad Davy of Elizabeth Street in North Richmond, not far away from here.
And I've got Gail Passmore of Strathpine. Where's Strathpine?
Strathpine is in New South Wales, huh? Queensland.
Queensland.
Oh, Queensland. Queensland.
Well, Queensland. You're from Queensland. You're not.
Oh, well, mind your own business then.
Yeah, that's
from Strathpine it's a wonderful spot, Strathpine. Been there many times. But I always thought it was in New South
it's
Wales.
It's a nice place.
Well done.
I hope you enjoyed yourself tonight.
Yes. Ross, if you would, please.
But I know we'll eat again some sunny day.
Keep smiling through.
Keep smiling through.
So easy, you make it so free. I never thought that I'd feel so good inside and still feel me. Thank you very much for joining us. Have yourselves a lovely weekend, will you please? For those of you who follow teams like I do that never win, have a terrific time. Tonight I'd like to leave you with a thought. If you're having trouble sleeping, try drinking a glass of warm milk
with a triple shot of brandy in it before you go to bed. I did it last night. I slept like a log. I woke up with my head in a fireplace. It was a wonder. Good night, everybody. I love your faces.